Welcome to History of Christian Thought. Well, what are we waiting for? Let's go. Come on. So this fourth and final session here for History of Christian Thought is on soteriology. But before we get into this final topic, first let's consider some of the questions that you guys asked from last week when we were talking about the Lord's Supper. So one of the questions was, at what age should someone take the Lord's Supper? Well, that's an interesting question because it's kind of difficult to really just place a specific age or number on when one should partake. That's kind of an arbitrary criteria. Some better things to consider is, what are the requirements for the Lord's Supper in the first place? So you have to believe in the real presence. You have to be able to acknowledge that you are expressing a common unity. You know, you agree with the doctrine of the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod. And then also, you prepare for that Lord's Supper. You confess your sins before God, and you are absolved. So there's those three things. So once a child is mature enough and intellectually mature enough to do those things, they can then partake in the Lord's Supper. Usually, the practice of the Lutheran Church is that we pair First Communion with confirmation. You know, it's just a practical thing to do, because once they're at that age, you know, commonly 8th grade or 9th grade, then they're mature enough to do those things, those requirements to partake in the Eucharist and the Lord's Supper. Next question. How do we encourage believers to partake? Well, a really good way to do that is just to offer the Lord's Supper as much as we can. To do that, to offer it, to make it available, will then encourage people to partake in it and to eat of the body and blood of Christ and receive that forgiveness. Another one, should we use wine or grape juice? What's the big deal anyway? Why does it even matter? Well, good question. In our Christian freedom, we are not bound to use wine, but there are some good reasons to use wine. You know, one being reverence, one being honoring the Lord's Supper, and imitating the way that Christ instituted it to his disciples. They're doing the Seder meal, and they would have used wine at that time. They would have used unleavened bread. So that's a good reason for us to do the same practice today. Now, are we bound to have to have wine? No, we don't. You know, so people that suffer alcoholism or for any personal reasons, that's why we offer non-alcoholic wine or grape juice. You know, we have that freedom to use it when we see fit. And the last question that we'll get to is, has the LCMS always practiced closed communion? Well, the short answer is yes, because that has always been the historical practice of the Catholic Church. And in the past, Lutherans in America have taken this very seriously. So when we have the public confession and then absolution in the church service, that is preparing us to partake in the Lord's Supper. In the past, a practice has been is that if anybody who wanted to partake, the Saturday before, the pastor of their church would go around to all of those households, and they would have a private confession that would prepare them for the Lord's Supper on Sunday morning, the next day. That practice has gone away now because, you know, churches have gotten so big, it's just not really practical anymore. And it's kind of unfortunate. You might be thinking, oh, pastor comes to my house and I got to tell him how bad of a person I am. You're like, oh, doesn't sound like a great thing, but there's some really great spiritual benefits to that practice, and it's kind of too bad that it's been done away with. But yeah, that's our questions from last time. Now we can get on into today's topic, soteriology. And I think a good place to start is just kind of asking the question, what is soteriology in the first place? That's a nice $5 word to kick around, but what does it mean? So, a simple definition is that soteriology is the doctrine of salvation. It explains what salvation is and how we receive it, and in some theories even merit it. But first, a quick refresher on what Lutherans believe on the subject. So let's take a look at Ephesians 2, verses 8 through 10. You might be familiar with these verses. You can get out your Bibles now if you want to read along, but I will read these for us at the moment. So it reads, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God. Not a result of works, so that no one may boast, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." So what I want you to do is take a moment, look at these verses, and I want you to analyze and describe where is justification present and where is sanctification present. So justification being, where do we receive salvation from God? And then sanctification then is us working out that faith, not so that we receive it or merit it, but then because God loves us, we go out and share that love with others. So I'll give you 2 minutes, take a look at these verses, and see where is justification present, where is sanctification present. Go ahead. Okay, let's bring it back together now. So, if we take a look at our verses, we should have seen that in verses 8 and 9, we're seeing justification. So we're saved by grace through faith. It's not anything we do, it's all through the power of God. And then in verse 10, it's talking about our sanctification. We do good works not to earn our salvation, but because God first loved us, and because those good works are commanded of us. They are necessary. So here is Lutheranism 101. This is our belief on salvation that really separates us from all other Christian denominations. This is what makes us Lutheran. So if a person is saved, God gets all the credit. But if they're condemned, it's their own fault. Now, we'll see in the rest of our session here how that really separates us from the other theories and explanations on how salvation works. So, some helpful information before we get into this. So, every theory of salvation can be mapped into a simple 2x2 arrangement because of these four elements. So, you'll notice this on the whiteboard up here, and then also on your notes sheet, we have the conversion map. And these are the elements that we'll be dealing with. There are two powers, God's and man's. And then two stages, the beginning and completion of conversion. And you can fill this out on your own charts on your note sheet. Alright, now this handy dandy chart came from an article by T.R. Halverson, and you'll notice at the bottom of the slides, the link is there for his article. Very good stuff. If you ever want to do some light reading and dive a little bit deeper into all this stuff, check out this article. Just Google a simple map of conversion terminology, and you'll find it on the Steadfast Lutherans website. Okay, so let's get into it. So when we're looking at these different explanations, we're going to kind of learn about it chronologically through history by way of the most prominent figures that made these claims. And we're going to start with Pelagius, who lived from 360 to 420. And he made the claim that Adam's sin only hurt Adam. So we're talking about original sin here, and really for Pelagius, the lack of that. He's going against original sin. He's claiming that, well, original sin, that's not really a thing. He says that if humanity wills, then humanity can exist without sin. So in this concept, you know, we don't have original sin to worry about. If we want to be good, we just have to try hard enough, and we can be good. For Pelagius, there is one power alone that works to convert a sinner, and that power is man's. So you'll notice on the chart in the bottom that man begins conversion and completes it. So to line that up with our chart on here, Pelagianism would fit right here. Now, this belief was then condemned as heresy at the 418 Council of Carthage. Now, what we're going to do next is the cookie metaphor. I have my visual aid right here. But the cookie metaphor is an activity that we're going to be doing for each four of these explanations on how salvation works. And I have instructions here on the next page, or the next slide. So in this metaphor, there are two beings involved in the scenario, man and God. So imagine that the cookie is salvation, and eating the cookie is a metaphor for receiving that salvation, which is conversion. Cookie. Based upon Pelagius' explanation of meriting salvation, this Pelagianism, where man begins it and then man completes it, describe who begins and completes conversion through the act of eating a cookie. If you get stuck, ask yourself the following questions. Who is picking up the cookie? Who puts the cookie in your mouth? And then who is eating this cookie? Now, I'll give you 2 minutes at your tables to try to describe this metaphor for how this works through the act of eating a cookie. And if you get stuck, if you're kind of like, I don't really know what's going on, don't worry. At the end of each of these sessions, I have a video of what this might kind of look like if you acted it out. So go ahead, you got 2 minutes. Go. All right, welcome back. So using the metaphor of a cookie to explain Pelagius' view might look something like this. Yep, you probably noticed that I enlisted Pastor Smith's help. He's very gracious to guest star in our video tonight. Okay, moving on to the next prominent figure in history. And this would be Augustine, the Bishop of Hippo. He lived from 354 to 430. Now, Augustine has a doctrine of original sin that we're very familiar with, and we should be, because Luther was an Augustinian monk. So Augustine claims that original sin infects all. We are saved by God's grace, which is freely given. Now, this is divine monergism. There is one power alone that works to convert a sinner, and that power is God. You'll see in the chart in the corner of the slide that God begins and completes the conversion. So to put that in our chart, divine monergism would go right here. Now, while Augustine and Lutherans would agree on divine monergism, we have a bit different definitions of what justification is. Now, for Augustine, in a simplified way, he kind of combines sanctification and justification. He says that when we are justified, we are made holy and sanctified throughout the rest of our life. And that combined brings us to salvation. Now, as for Lutherans, justification is purely forensic. God declares us holy and righteous, kind of like in a courtroom setting when someone is declared to be not guilty. But nonetheless, elements of Luther's thought can be seen in the Church Fathers. Just kind of trying to hit home that Luther's ideas, this wasn't something that he just invented out of thin air or made up himself. His thought is really just what the Catholic teachers before him had been teaching in the past. He rediscovered what the gospel had always been. All right. So again, we'll do the cookie metaphor. I'll give you 2 minutes to figure out how this would work with divine monergism, where God begins and completes conversion. Go ahead. All right, let's bring it back together again. If you were to act this out through eating a cookie, it might look something like this. Now, if you wanted to be a real stickler on this metaphor, where might the metaphor break apart? Any ideas? Well, possibly the metaphor could break apart when the person is doing the chewing and the eating. That could be seen as, oh, man's power is involved in conversion. But if you're being a monergist really strictly, you'd say, no, man has no part in it. You know, we are dead in our sins. God does all the work. So we couldn't really reenact this, but maybe a better demonstration would be God taking the cookie and shoving it down your throat and into your stomach, where the person does absolutely nothing to receive that grace, to get that salvation. God does all the work. But, you know, unfortunately, we can't do that in real life. Wouldn't really work out. All right, moving on to our next figure, John Cashin, lived from AD 360 to 435, after Pelagius and Augustine. And John Cashin, he was a monk from France, he had a bit of a problem with both Pelagius and Augustine. He thought, with Augustine's claim on how salvation works, is that if it's by grace alone, then there is laxity. And he's looking around at society and he's saying, well, if salvation's only by grace, then people won't do the good things they need to do. You know, these people are impious, they're just falling into sin left and right. You know, this can't be the solution. It can't be the answer. But then, if you go off of Pelagius' teaching, if it's by works alone, then there is legalism. Then you're always worried about, well, I just gotta do the right thing in order to earn my salvation. You know, what if I mess up, you know, this will never work out. So he's got a problem with both views. So he comes up with this, kind of a combination of the two. So if man begins and God completes, then there is a longing for God, a longing for salvation, and this is semi-Pelagianism. So man begins, God completes, that fit in right here in this box. And what are we going to do next? Well, first, it was condemned as heresy at the Council of Orange in 529. John Cashin, your hybrid here didn't work out, you know, and you still reject original sin. That's a big no-no. We can't do that. It's not what Scripture scripts. But next, we're doing again the cookie metaphor. So, in this one, if man begins, God completes his conversion, how would we act this out by eating a cookie? You have 2 minutes again. Go ahead. All right, welcome back. Demonstrating eating a cookie with semi-Pelagianism might look something like this. All right, I hope you're enjoying your cookie metaphors so far. We only got one more once we talk about Aquinas. Now, we talked about Aquinas when we were looking at the Lord's Supper. We watched a video on him instead of reading one of his excerpts from the Summa. But Aquinas would make a new claim. His claim about salvation is called synergism. You have prevenient grace, grace given to us by God, that gives us the ability to claim our salvation, claim our justification, and then there is cooperating grace. So there are two powers here that combine and work together to convert a sinner. The power of God and the power of man. God begins it, and then man completes it. And, well, we only have one box left, so it would be right here. Now, sometimes we will label Catholics as being works righteous, which is sort of true, since that's how that justification is completed. But Catholics themselves would say, no, like, that's totally false. Like, and it really, it is a simplified view of what their belief is. They acknowledge original sin and that we are depraved and that we need that prevenient grace from God for us to even want to be holy, for us to even want to be righteous. But once we receive that grace from God, then we can begin doing those works to earn, to merit their own salvation. So that's kind of a more nuanced view of what they really believe. Good works are necessary for salvation, not because divine power is insufficient, but because that is the way God works. So this is important here. For the Roman Catholic, from Aquinas, his tradition, this is their belief today, good works are necessary for salvation. As a Lutheran, we would say, no, good works are necessary. But that's where we end that sentence. We can say and freely say that good works are necessary, but they are not necessary for salvation. Good works are a part of our sanctification. It's the things that we've been commanded to do, not to earn anything, but because God first loved us through sending his son Jesus to die on the cross so that we may have eternal life. You know what we're going to do next? The cookie metaphor. Okay, you know the drill. You have another 2 minutes to figure this out. How would you act this out if God begins conversion and then man completes it? Go ahead. Okay, welcome back. If you acted out synergism with the cookie metaphor, it might look something like this. All right, awesome. So we've gotten through the four prominent figures that had these four different claims on how salvation worked. We had Pelagius, Augustine, that's divine monergism, what Lutherans hold to, then John Cassian with semi-Pelagianism, and then lastly, Thomas Aquinas, who was a synergist, held to the belief of synergism. We filled out our conversion map here on the board, but it's also here on the slide as well, just to kind of show that to you again. And that brings us to the end of our session. So depending on how much time you have left tonight in our hour, I also have some additional discussion questions here that you can take a look at. But if you don't have time, that's all right. You can close in prayer now. And these three questions are, sometimes we hear statements like, I've made a decision for Jesus to accept him into my heart. Why would Lutherans shy away from this kind of language? And what heresy, even, does it sound similar to? The next one is, how should Lutherans speak about their conversion or justification? And then finally, while learning about the Roman Catholic, that was Aquinas' explanation of salvation, did anything surprise you? So, I'm so glad that you were watching this recording, either in person or at home. And thank you for being with us for this History of Christian Thought course. The next 2 weeks we will have off. This is the final session in this course. And then we will be beginning a new study on Tuesday night, July 27th, and it's called Callings for Life. We'll be looking at how we should rightly consider God's plan for our life. I'm really looking forward to it. I hope to see many of you actually in person this time, and not a recording again. Well, we'll see ya. Have a good night. And make sure you have a cookie before you go. You've earned it tonight.